Just how important is communication? Why don't you just think about that for a minute? How important is communication? And how insidious is what multi-billion corporations are doing to us? I'm Randall Terry. This is Voice of Resistance. Welcome to the program, friend. I'm your servant, Randall Terry. This television show can be seen on a little bit over 30 million television sets. We're in a little over 30 million homes via the network that the Walk TV has put together for this particular program. Some of the Walk TV shows are seen in more homes. That's how many we're in. I'm happy with that. How many people are watching this show right now? I don't know. But I know that there are over 30 million people that can watch. That means that I have a privilege to communicate. Now, there are some shows that do things like have a YouTube channel or have podcasts. We just started a YouTube channel. Very few people have subscribed. We just don't push it. I've never done a podcast. I just never have. I'm a traditional broadcaster. I've done radio and television for over a quarter century. So that's the type of broadcaster I am. There's a whole new world of broadcasting, of which I clearly know very little. One thing that we know is that communicating through tweets helped President Trump win the White House. Literally helped him win the White House. Is it 120, 140 characters, however many it is? I mean, that's just, it's amazing to me, okay? It's flat out amazing. Now, we created recently a TV series, movie series called What Would Mohammed Do? Islamic Terrorism Explained. And it started getting traction. But something started to go wrong. Namely, when you typed in my name or the name of Mohammed or Islam into a search engine, put a picture up of a search engine, okay? And make a little clip or whatever. You see, you type it in there on Google or on Bing or whatever, and then pop, up comes this list of various websites. Well, my name used to come up more. My press releases would come up. And then suddenly they disappeared, as if they didn't exist. And I thought, what's going on? This cannot be happening. So I started to do some deep digging, and a friend and I, who's also a broadcaster, Roger the Shrubber. Roger, if you're listening out there, greetings. Roger Fredenberg, he's got a nationally syndicated radio show. He and I were literally on the phone or on Skype or something and looking, digging, and we found a story by Search Engine Land, and then another story by Associated Press from mid-April. And each of those stories showed that Google, who is the king of the hill, that Google had hired 10,000 raters. They created a 160-page manual, and they told them, among other things, as they rate a website, to look for things that are offensive, to look for things that are upsetting, and to determine if they think, given the standards of their community, whether or not a website meets the standard, the expectation of somebody who's looking. And they specifically used Islam as an example. And what they showed in the offensive one and the upsetting one was a website by Jan Morgan, where she talks about her life being threatened and the violence of Islam in the Quran. And they told their people, flag a site like this as upsetting and offensive. So it would go to the back of the line in a search engine or might just disappear altogether. And then they said, they used another illustration, if somebody puts the word in Islam, if Jan Morgan's website comes up, they are to flag that as fails to meet the need, a complete failure. So there's a sliding scale, like perfectly meets the need, highly meets the need, medium meets the need a little but not so much, barely meets the need, and then fails to meet the need. In other words, completely blackballed. And they told their raters to mark that as fails to meet the need. And they even said in the instructions, even if somebody is looking for a site like this, we still want it marked fails to meet the need. In other words, using Islam as the example, they taught their raters how to keep people from being communicated with. So this is about communication. Don't go away, I've got more to communicate with you before I get censored by someone at the NSA. Can they do that? Can they do that? Have Muslim terrorists hijacked the peaceful religion of Islam? Or is there more to the story? The answer lies in the life of one man, Muhammad, the founder of Islam. Muslim terrorists see themselves inside a 1,400-year-old story, a narrative that focuses on specific events in the life of Muhammad. We are going to look at Muhammad's life using their most sacred literature. We will look at Muhammad at the Battle of Badr. We'll see him deal with those who mock him. We'll see the times when he used deception. We'll witness Muhammad's anti-Semitism. And yes, we will discuss Muhammad and his teachings concerning sex, slavery, and jihad. Friend, if you want to understand Islamic terrorism, get this series today. I'm asking you the question today. By the way, I'm Randall Terry. Thank you for joining me. How important is communication? Let's just make this really rudimentary, really pedantic. If you're in a room with somebody who cannot hear, they're actually physically deaf, what kind of impediment, what kind of problem does that create for being able to communicate? If they can't hear? Or what if, conversely, somebody can hear, but the person over here is mute, can't talk? Does that inhibit communication? Right? Well, what if the person who's deaf can read? But the person who can speak can't write. Does that inhibit communication? Yes, of course. When nations, in days gone by before Google Translate, when nations would try and communicate on a trade issue, a border issue, heaven forbid an issue of war or threatening war, they had ambassadors, diplomats, and what did they have? If they spoke a different language, what did they have? Translators. They had people that could translate for them so that they communicated with one another. What are your demands? What are your demands? What are your desires? What are your desires? What do you want? What do you want? There's communication going on. Let's make this spiritual. How blessed are the feet of him who brings what? Good news. Who publishes tidings of peace. Publishes tidings, communicates good news. All of this has to do with communication. We literally don't have the ability to see souls come into the kingdom of heaven through the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ and his shed blood for us without communication. It doesn't happen. Do you see where this is going? Communication is central to humanity. It is part of what makes us to be manifestly made in the image of God. Animals can communicate with each other, but not to the depth and with the precision that humans can. Not with issues of the soul and of eternity. Okay? That is reserved for the human race. We are made in God's image, and God has communicated to us through the Word made flesh. Okay? He gave revealed law to Moses on Mount Sinai. He communicated with them with writing on the stones with his finger. He communicated with them with speaking out of the midst of the fire. They heard, they understood. Okay? The Bible says the things revealed belong to us and to our children and to as many as the Lord our God shall call. So communication between God and man and God through prayer, man and man. It's really critical. Even man and animals. We have dogs, okay? We train our animals and we train them to respond to verbal commands. We have right now seen in this election cycle that just happened, we've seen fake news come out of CNN, ABC, CBS, polls, just fake, deceptive news, okay? Thank God President Trump was able to circumvent that. And there were enough people out there that said, no, I don't think so. You people are lying to us because you are liars, okay? So their communications efforts failed, right? But in part, it was because alternate media, the web, emails, Twitter accounts, YouTube videos, part of their failure to communicate lies and to deceive us was because there was an alternative communication. Something is happening right now. Google, and without question, Bing and others are following suit. I don't know to what level, but I'm seeing it in real time. Google is choking out those places that communicate, literally choking them out by making them disappear from the search engines. But there's something, if it was possible for something to be even more insidious, they're doing that. The New York Times reported on it 2 days ago. I'm going to tell you when I come back from this break how Google and other internet providers are trying to destroy voices that they don't want to be heard. Friend, thank you for being a part of this program. If you like what you're hearing and seeing, you will enjoy my books. The problem is, a couple of them are out of print. Operation Rescue, which is about the group and the movement that I founded, and The Judgment of God, which is self-explanatory. They're out of print, but you can get them online as a PDF. You can read them on your device. In fact, if you want to save money and you don't want an actual book, all of my books are available at our website as a PDF, and they're really inexpensive. So go to the website that you see on your screen, voiceofresistance.com or randallterry.com, or if you want to call to get any more information, call 304-289-3700. That's 304-289-3700. God bless you and thank you for your support. Welcome back to the program, friend. All right, so Google has put in place the raiders. Raiders, they are raiding. They're the cyber book burners, okay? They're literally keeping people from finding stuff like my movie series, What Would Muhammad Do? But they're doing more than that. There's a fairly significant body of broadcasters, people who do online radio, online television, who get money, sometimes significant money, from Google with ad revenue share. So when you go to a website, you see those ads, they pop up hither and yon, right? And they are distributing that money. So a car company writes Google a $500,000 check, and then Google keeps a portion of that, but they also spread a portion out where they're dropping in the ad. They're saying, look, we're sharing the revenue with you. You're producing content. People are going to your site, and when you reach a certain threshold of viewers, we're going to give you a little piece of the pie. This helped to develop a significant amount of broadcasters. For reasons known only to Google, okay, they have decided that, and this is without the complaint of major advertisers, mind you, they've decided that certain websites, we just think that Mercedes wouldn't want their ad there, or Procter & Gamble, or whoever, whatever, all right? And so the New York Times reported on one company, this is just one example of many, that went from $20,000 a month, all right, with a staff and infrastructure to, I believe that the story said 6 cents, 6 pennies. So what Google knows what they're doing. They know exactly what they're doing. The first thing they're doing is choking out the search engine so they don't find us. The second thing is they're making it so that we go away. If they bankrupt a news company, a little online site that gets a lot of traffic, that people are interested, what do they got to say? If they bankrupt them, they're gone. They don't even have to worry about the search engine rating anymore because the lights are off. Think in your lifetime, if you're my age or older, think in your lifetime how many newspapers merged and then just, some of them just went away. They're gone. You used to have 2, 3, 4 newspapers in any given major city. Almost every major city except for New York and I think Los Angeles, and don't quote me on that because there's probably going to be more, but just a handful now, Chicago, most major cities are down to one newspaper. And there are cities that are moving towards newspapers that are completely online, completely digital. If you want the news, go to your phone with an app or go to your computer. So what Google is doing is saying, yeah, we accept XYZ Times, the online version of this newspaper. We'll let our ads go there. But this news source, this online news source, they're critical of Hillary. They're critical of Islam. They're pro-Donald Trump. Or fill in the blank. Whatever it is, there's some element of their presentation of words, images, that Google does not want to exist. They can bankrupt them. Poof. Give them 30 days, 60, 90, 120 days, and they're just gone. That's what happened with these newspapers in various cities. The buildings were shuttered. The windows boarded up. The buildings sold. It became a part of history. They're gone. Their editorial board is gone. Their editorial positions are gone. Their headlines, their banners, their staff of writers, it's all gone. That's where Google is headed. You see, what the cyber world did, as much as I despise and loathe much of the cyber world, first it was there were three major networks and AP and a string of major newspapers, New York Times, Washington Post being the most important. Along came cable. And then we went from three news services plus PBS, if you were lucky, to 100, then 1,000, okay? Suddenly there was an alternative. We saw the stranglehold of the major news go away, and along comes Fox News and CNN, okay? And then we start to think, CNN and MSNBC, and we're not even sure, we're not trusting cable news, and along comes the internet. Unfortunately, these big, huge corporations have the money and have the resources to strangle the life out of these small alternative media sources so that ultimately what they hope is that they can get all the way back to where communications and the flow of information and the editorial viewpoint and the ethical slant of the news and the information that's being given is in the hands of a few. And I have a hot flash for you. Those few are almost, not totally, but almost exclusively anti-Christ, anti-God in their agenda. The flow of information that has seen a real boom in the last 20, 30 years is taking a sudden and steep nosedive, and most people don't even know what's going on. I'll be right back. What Would Mohammed Do? Islamic Terrorism Explained is the best movie series documentary ever produced on the life of Mohammed and Islam. How do I know? Because it's what critics are saying. John Moore, radio host and author, said, "I learned more from What Would Mohammed Do about Islam and Islamic terrorism than I've learned from everything I ever read and watched in my entire life." Best-selling author Dr. Bill Warner said, "What Would Mohammed Do is the best movie series, TV production on the life of Mohammed and Islamic terrorism that has ever been produced." Friends, this is what the experts are saying. No one has ever done what we've done. I encourage you to get 1, 2, 4 copies. Call 304-289-3700. That's 304-289-3700. 1-800-289-3700 or order it at the address or the website that you see on the screen. Friend, we have a series that will help you and those you love to have an impact on this country. It's called Insurrecta Nex. That's Latin for revolution against the killing of innocent people. This is the history, the philosophy, and the theology of social revolution in America. We look at the Stamp Act, the Boston Tea Party, the abolition of slavery, the abolition of child labor, women's voting rights, the civil rights movement. All of them have this in common: courage, sacrifice, dedication, and in-your-face tactics and rhetoric. That's one of the reasons that we've been losing the culture wars the last 40 years, is because the bad guys are using these tactics and we aren't. We will send you this 14-part TV series along with these manuals for students, a teacher's facilitator guide for only $40. Go to 304-289-3700, 304-289-3700. Welcome back to the program, friend. I'm Randall Terry. I hope that you have a great weekend. Again, I want to thank the Walk TV Network for the privilege, the honor of having been carried on this network for years, and I hope I get to do it for years to come. This is not a swan song here. But the reason I do this show, we struggle to make it financially, okay? We literally go week to week sometimes, and it's a constant burden. But you'll notice that we very rarely talk about money on the program. We try and bring you content because the purpose of the show is to communicate truth and to mobilize our viewers to some level of action. Even if it's just communicating truth to their friends at the water cooler at work, or their family at family get-togethers, or in their church, or with strangers, you follow me. I want to equip you. That's my mission. My goal is to equip you. I'm the philosophical arms dealer for the right-hand side of your brain, to equip you with the theological, philosophical, historical ammunition that you need, rhetorical firepower that you need to help truth and justice prevail in the public square. That's why I do the show. So if you go to our website, if you're of the age where you like using the internet, you can go to randallterry.com, and what you will find is a fairly significant amount of free material. And we've debated this for years. Sell a subscription. Sell the episodes for 99 cents a piece. Sell, sell, sell. And I haven't been able to bring myself to it. Maybe I should. Maybe people would say, wow, there's more value here if I did charge them 99 cents. I don't know. But what I do know is that you can download PDFs of virtually all of my books. I think maybe all of them. Download PDFs for free. Just for free. Every episode we've done, free. It's all there. Series that we've done, training videos, it's all there for free. Because content is critical for the formation of the soul, the mind, to help raise the levels of courage. Now, one thing that we offer that is not entirely free is our new movie documentary series called What Would Mohammed Do? Islamic Terrorism Explained. That particular series, you can watch one episode for free. And then if you want to purchase it, you can. I encourage you to go and watch the one episode. I know that most of our viewers have not yet taken that one step. I have to tell you this little testimony. I spoke yesterday with a former imam who I'm hoping to have on our program. He's a former Muslim imam, okay? And now he's a Christian. And he's been watching our series, What Will Muhammad Do? And he's been blown away. He watched 10 episodes yesterday and said he could not find a single flaw. Now, this is a man who was a Muslim imam. Said he couldn't find a single flaw. Go to the website, watch it. If you like what you see, buy it. And if you think, Randall, you know what, I don't even want to get the series, or I've already got it, but I'm going to just donate $50, $100, $500, please do. We have hit a rough spot. We have hit a rough spot with our show. We need help. And if you like the program and you like the content, then I'm asking you to join us. And no matter what, please pray for us and understand the value of communication. Thank you.